Let us give the Lord praise, everyone. Strength like no other. Now I'm going to ask you to join with me as we sing this congregational song, When We All Get to Heaven. When we all get to heaven, God bless you. Our first reading will be coming from Psalm 91. And at this time, I'm going to invite Alexis Watkiss to do our first reading in the name of the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I'll be reading my cousin's favorite scripture. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my fortress. He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand. But it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and shew him my salvation. Here ends the reading of God's holy word.
Amen, everyone. We thank God for the reading of his word. Pastor Monica Moulton will come to us now to minister in song. Monica Moulton. Is she here? All right.
Good evening and good morning, and praise the Lord to everyone. My condolences go to the family on behalf of my husband, Pastor Jasper Moulton, my children, Tanya and Charlene, and also the grandchildren and their husbands. God bless you as I sing in Jesus' name. When peace, like a river, attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and had shed his own blood for my soul. Oh, hallelujah. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. Hallelujah. It is well with my soul. Hallelujah. Oh, it is well. It is well with my soul. My sin, or the bliss of the glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole. Is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, oh, it is well with my soul.
Lovely rendition. It is well with my soul. Selwyn Pitters will come now. It's a close friend to give his tribute.
Good morning. Let me first express my condolences to Mr. Diedrick's immediate family, his children, his mother, his uncles and aunts, his brothers and sisters, his father, the crew that traveled all the way from Jamaica yesterday, and all the people that traveled from the United States and all over Canada to be here today. Now, if you take a look at the order of service, you'll see that my tribute comes just before Mr. Diedrick's three children, and they were his world. And I should say something as well before I pause at this stage to also recognize Rika. They were his world. And outside of football, they meant the world to him. Everyone in his circle knew them or had known about them. Kendrick was involved in football from since he was a toddler. He used to be in the locker room. And when his dad died, a lot of the players, some of them are here, they're asking about him. And asking about Dominique, just to make sure that they were fine and Isley. And so Diedrick was proud as well of his roots. He always spoke about bamboo, and most of us didn't know where it is, but it's probably a hamlet somewhere in Jamaica. If it's not, somebody's gonna tell me something. Now, Diedrick and I became friends shortly after he returned to Canada from his stint in the National Football League to play in the Canadian Football League. And his mother actually introduced us, and thank you very much for that, Karen. Now, Diedrick had a bachelor's degree in legal studies, and he had an incomplete master's. I know most of you don't know that he actually did some studies in law and criminology. So he had this idea because somebody in the Canadian Football League that he knew was also a lawyer. And so he had this idea that, you know, let me explore the legal realm and see how it works. So I'm a lawyer, and so we became workout buddies. I work out with him, and he worked in my law office. So during the off season, he would work in my law office, and he got introduced to a lot. He was involved in a lot of big cases that I was involved in the early 2000s. And I have to tell you that when we go to the gym, and Valerie Steele and Mike Roberts and a few other people who are here knows that, Diedrick, his work ethic in the gym was unmatched. I mean, people used to stop their workouts just to watch Diedrick work. And he used to put the treadmill at a maximum 25 and sprint. And I used to be just amazed at how this guy can run on that treadmill. He was the hardest worker in the gym. At the time Diedrick came into my life, and it's quite ironic that he died at 44, I was just about to turn 40. And some of his family and so on know the backstory because he told them. So I had my sort of insecurities about turning 40. And I think I was fearful, right, Valerie? I was kind of fearful at turning 40 for a number of reasons. And so Diedrick helped to keep me fit. He helped to keep me grounded. And I say that because sometimes in our professional spheres, you know, we have a whole circle of friends, a whole circle of employees around us, and they're important. And Diedrick was extremely important in my life. At the end of a busy court day doing murder trials and serious trials, we would actually go to the gym and work out. And I'm still trying to, at this time, I'm trying to figure out how I got the strength to do that after court. But Diedrick was fundamental to that. He also connected with my clients, whether it was uttering inspiring words to them, providing them with complimentary tickets to the games, or connecting with their families, signing footballs for them, or giving them his little cards, his little player cards. Diedrick also enmeshed himself within the legal fraternity. And so he became friends with a lot of lawyers, and he bonded, and y'all are gonna laugh at this, but he bonded quite well with the female lawyers. I can tell you all stories, and Mike, you know some of the stories. And I heard his uncle, Fred, was telling us a story the other day when we were at the house for the nine nights. Fred told us a story, and I was like, I can relate to this. I heard a story last night from someone who knew Diedrick for a long time. And the person that told me this story is in the room, and the person who is directly related to the story is in the room as well. So in middle school, Diedrick and a friend went to the convenience store, and the friend bought a soda. And the friend invited Diedrick to go and get a soda as well. And Diedrick bought milk instead. And the friend said to him, well, why are you not getting a soda? Why are you drinking milk? And Diedrich replied to the friend, I cannot drink soda. I'm going to play in the NFL one day. And he did make it to the NFL. So when you talk about determination, when you talk about tenacity, when you talk about grit and urge to succeed, that was Diedrich. His tenure in the Canadian Football League was the longest with the Montreal Alouettes, and that was his most cherished moments, and certainly a lot of players from the Alouettes are here, and Mark Trestman is going to speak to his tenure in the Canadian Football League and the Montreal Alouettes. When he was with the Alouettes, I got to know a lot of the family of the players, Kerry Carter and his family who are here, Josh Burke and his family, Evan Coburn and his family, and they're here as well. I attended two of his Grey Cup games, and I think I should speak about his Grey Cup games because, you know, when we attended the Grey Cup games, I saw the pride that his mother felt. I saw the joy that she felt. And she even walked taller when we were going to the stadium. I don't know if she remembered when we were walking up those hills to get to that stadium to watch the Grey Cup. She had a lot of pride, and she was very proud of her son, her only son. One thing you're going to hear from most people, Diedrich made us laugh, and he always had something positive to say. He tried to be positive. He tried to make people laugh. He was the life of the party. Even as lawyers, we used to, when we hung out with Diedrich, we used to party all weekend, and then we robe up and go to court on Monday morning. It was quite the life. And it wasn't an irresponsible life. It was a life of meaning, it was a life of worth, and it was a life of finding balance. And I believe that Diedrich did that. So I saw him in the last hours of his life, and the close family that were there, his children, his girlfriend Rika, the children's mom, his mother, we all formed a circle with the pastor, and we prayed that Friday evening. And I don't think any of us knew that shortly after 2 a.m. he would have been gone on Saturday morning. His aunt was there as well, Sandra Moulton. So Diedrich died a few hours after we formed that circle and pray. And I want to say that I appreciated his love, I appreciated his camaraderie, I appreciated his friendship, and I just wanted to say travel safely, Diedrich. Thank you.
Thank you, Selwyn. I'm going to ask everyone just to put your hands together to celebrate the life of this man. Come on, help me. You can do better than that. Thank God for the time he gave him to us. Amen. This time, we're going to invite the children. A tribute to our beloved father from Dominique, Kendrick, Eiley. They will come now and speak on behalf of their father.
Hello, everyone. I'm just here today to read on behalf of my brother and sister, Isley and Kendrick. I'll be reading one of the Father's Day cards that I've written for my dad. It's one of the most recent cards that I wrote for him. It's one of the last cards that I wrote for him. Happy Father's Day, Dad. It's important that you know and always remember that we are all here for you, supporting you with every step of your journey. Your strength and resilience inspire us all. You are a true fighter, and every single one of us believes in you. Thank you, Dad, for being an amazing father. We love you so much, it's hard to even put into words. We love you because you have always, always made sure that we felt and experienced your love. And we all hope with all of our hearts that you can hear, feel, and experience our love for you too.
Our love for our dad is eternal. Our love for our dad is everlasting. Our love for our dad is indescribable. Our hearts are only so heavy because of the sheer weight of his love. His presence in each of our lives is without question something that's going to stay with us forever. I love my father. All of us love our father.
Thank you.
Let us continue to hold them up in praise and encouragement. It's hard, but God will take you through. Hang on in there, kids. God will help you through it, and you have a great support system around you, and you will be all right. Can we say amen? Bitter Jacks will be coming to us now with the second reading from Psalm 23.
Good morning, everyone. Before I begin reading, I just wanted to take a moment to acknowledge my beautiful cousin, Dahrran's beautiful mother, his beautiful children, friends, and family who are all here today. I don't think that having to be here today on his homegoing is ever going to make sense to any of us. But I do have to believe that it is part of his plan. And I also hope that the words that I'm going to be reading will bring you guys some form of comfort, the way that it has brought my family comfort through death, life, joy, and pain. So Psalm 23, a psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
I must ask at this time that in the interest of time, I'm going to ask the following persons who are coming to give the tributes to manage the time well. I hope I say it nicely.
At this time, we ask that you turn your attention to the entrance of the church doors. From a young age, Dahrran showed remarkable athletic abilities on and off the field. With the support and guidance of a remarkable single mother, Dahrran propelled his talents from the football fields in Scarborough, Ontario, to the football fields in the United States and back again to Canada. He achieved great success throughout his college and professional careers, winning various awards and accolades. In honor of Dahrran's accomplishments and sportsmanship, his brothers, who played on the field with him, coached with him, or were coached by him, will pay their final respects to the Greek god by laying down their jerseys on his casket in honor of his final down. Each jersey represents a team that Dahrran played on or coached, and has been signed by former teammates, coaches, staff, and athletes. The jerseys will be placed in the casket at the end of the service as a sign of respect from his brothers to remain with Dahrran forever. Here to honor Dahrran today is his brother-in-law, Major Pierre Malte of the Royal Canadian Air Force. Major Malte is carrying Dahrran's helmet one last time for his final farewell. Carrying the jersey from the Scarborough Thunder Football Club is Dahrran's friend, club teammate, and former Cedar Bray collegiate teammate, Matthew Farmer McNiven. Carrying the jersey from Cedar Bray Collegiate in honor of his late brother, Casey Gordon, who played with Dahrran, is one of Dahrran's best friends, high school friend, and brother, Josh Gordon. Carrying the jersey from the University of Nebraska is Dahrran's best friend and also brother of the late Casey Gordon, Brian Gordon. Carrying the jersey from the Durham Dolphins Football Club, where Dahrran coached, is defensive end Anthony Adams. Carrying the jersey from the Hamilton Ticats is former Ticat running back Avon Coburn. Carrying the jersey from the Montreal Alouettes is Dahrran's friend and former teammate, fullback Kerry Carter. And finally, carrying the game ball in honor of his father, coach, and hero is Dahrran's son, defensive end Kendrick Kenny Diedrick.
Just stand up tall, look them in the face and say, bright star up in the sky. From that mountain peak up high, hey, I made it. I'm the world's greatest. And I'm that little bit of hope. When my back's against the ropes, I can feel it. I'm the world's greatest. Giant, I am an eagle, oh, I am a lion, down in the jungle, I am a marching band, I am the people, oh, I am a helping hand, I am a hero, if anybody asks you who I am, just stand up tall, look them in the face and say, that star up in the sky, from that mountain peak up high, hey, I made it, I'm the world's greatest, and I'm that little bit of hope, when my back's against the ropes, I can feel it, I'm the world's greatest.
In the ring of life, I'll reign love,
I will reign.
Put our hands together for that beautiful presentation. It is so wonderful to remember, to recall the life of someone great in the field of sport, in life, in family. Today, we remember Didi in the name of the Lord. Come on, put your hands together again for that. The next tribute will be coming from his coach, Mark Trestman, Montreal Alouettes, Roberto Budo Allen, Scarborough Thunder Football Club. I'm going to ask you, in the interest of time, to manage your minutes, please. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm not sure I can do that, Pastor. I'm going to be honest with you up front. Selwyn, I'm going to be double downing on much of your words and seeing Dahrran's children up here. I just want them to know that even back in 2008, 2009, we were always talking about you. He was always talking about you. I wanted you to know that today. And it's a tremendous privilege. Rika and Karen, thank you for this honor of being able to come up here today. It's an honor and a privilege to stand before all of you. I'm confident that I don't just represent myself, but so many others that are here today that were part of Double D's life's journey. His family, of course, Rika, friends, teachers, coaches alike. I'm sure I speak for everyone without hesitation. We're not just here present to grieve a loss, but as the pastor said earlier, to celebrate his life. We all know, this is an incredible tribute to him, all the people that are here, what an incredible and remarkable individual that Double D was, and with heavy hearts, we're gonna say goodbye today to a great son, a great father, exceptional player, a wonderful teammate, and unquestionably, and I believe this with all my heart, an extraordinary human being. In my opinion, an individual who defined what great character was all about, what a compassionate heart was all about. He was a great teammate, and he should be someone we all should aspire to be like. It was a privilege to coach Double D in Montreal, but he was also an essential piece of our coaching staff in Toronto, and some of you probably didn't recognize that, but I hired him in 2017 because he was the missing piece, the piece that would show our players what it looked like and how you acted to be a true champion, what that looked like in actions and in words. He immediately connected with our players, and he did exactly that. He got us to where we wanted to go. He's a big part of that. In both instances, as a player that I coached and coached with, I can honestly say, and Selwyn, you said it, there was never a bad day for Double D. Always positive, always a smile, never a complaint, never an ounce of negative energy. And the football locker room is kind of like that. We all have our lives going on outside, but when we get in the locker room, we got to give it up for the team, and Double D was the first to do that. The first thing that I think about with Double D, and when I think about his name, a smile crosses my face, and I know you recognize that. But my thoughts don't initially go to the football player that he was, but to his infectious smile, his zest for life, his absolute love for conversation like no one that I'd ever been around, his upbeat personality, his incredible sense of humor, and what great leaders and teammates do, they bring people together. And nobody could do it better on our teams than Double D. Double D not only had the charisma to bring us together, but he did it authentically, he did it selflessly, he did it egolessly, and he did it what I was amazed by. He did it remarkably, effortlessly. It was who he was. So just a quick story. On most days, those 5 years in Montreal and 2 years in Toronto, we had to take a ride on the bus to practice. The bus rides took anywhere from 20 to 40 minutes to get to the practice field. So there was a quick transition from meetings onto the bus, and the bus really became an opportunity. It was our locker room. It was an opportunity, in most cases, to be without our phones and for players and coaches to engage in conversation with each other. Conversations that would strengthen the authenticity of our relationships that are so crucial to winning football teams, and most importantly, to lifelong friendships that result from it. And we see that here today. To me, this is where Double D was truly his best. And Selwyn, you kind of said it. Double D was the star of the show on the bus. I would sit in front preparing for practice, and I would be entertained by Double D mediating conversations that range from what I would call Jerry Seinfeld conversations, simply all about nothing, to the most prominent current affairs. Here is where it gets hard to explain for people that didn't know Double D. Double D always came off as a guy who was an expert on everything, but not in an egotistical way or an entitled way, but in a way that just kept everybody upbeat, constantly entertained, and at times had me simply hunched over in laughter while the conversations continued. The conversations kept us loose, allowed the time on the bus to go by quickly, and of course brought us together. Double D just had the gift. And then, as I said earlier, Double D, through words and most importantly through his actions, defined what it meant to be a true leader and a great teammate. The unique gift Double D had would not have worked by itself, but he backed it up. He always backed it up in walkthroughs, in meetings, and on the field. He was respectful to everyone, holding coaches, teammates, and support staff in the highest regard. He understood that everything mattered, regardless, and everyone mattered, regardless of their role. Double D was selfless, entirely selfish. He was a role player to Avon Coburn, who's here today, but he was also a special team standout. This is what I really wanted to get across today. Double D was, in my opinion, the definition of pure joy as a player. I believe true joy in sports can only be achieved two ways. You have to accept your role on the team, and you have to be grateful to be a part of the journey. You have to be selfless. You literally have to want it more for your team than you want it for yourself. The team had to come first. I never remember a moment where Double D made it about himself, ever, or put his desires ahead of the team. When you are grateful and you are selfless, you have the opportunity to do what we all truly are meant to do, and that's to live in the moment and in the flow of life. This is the formula I see for joy, and I think Double D defined it. I never heard him complain. I never heard of him complaining. He was the poster child, an example that individual accomplishments are secondary to the collective goals of the team. And as the head coach, I would always say to the team, we don't want any high-maintenance coaches and we don't want any high-maintenance players. What do I mean by that? It meant that we did not want anyone in our locker room who made it about themselves, who could not or would not put the team ahead of themselves. And I can't name anyone who was more low-maintenance than Double D. A father you should be extremely proud of, and I know you are. Double D, and I'll finish with a few more things, Pastor, but I can't help myself. I'm sorry. I haven't been in front of this larger group for a while, so I thought I'd take advantage of it. Now, from my heart, I can tell you that Double D was a great teammate, and I know there's four or five that we played and coached together here today from Montreal. Double D was a great teammate. Someone said it here, I think someone said impeccable work ethic, impeccable. Some of the qualities of a great teammate is they're intensely prepared and reliable. I don't ever remember Double D being late or missing anything, from meetings to walkthrough. A great teammate can be trusted, and Double D was trusted. He was trustworthy both on and off the field. He could be relied on and fulfill his commitments to maintain confidentiality, to act with integrity, and most importantly on the football field, to take care of the football. Kendrick, that was an outstanding job of locking up the rock coming down. I know how proud you are of your dad. That ball was locked up tight, wasn't it? And I know he taught you that. Double D was trustworthy. When you are a trustworthy teammate, your teammates trust you to have their backs and to always act in the best interests of the team. And for Double D, to my recollection, there was on the field, there was a lot less talk, but focus on doing his job. In Montreal, Double D's role on offense was our closer. The closer has to be prepared, he has to be dependable, and he has to be trustworthy. I know Avon's, who's here today, didn't like it because we took Avon in the game and put in Double D to be the closer, because with 3 minutes left in the game, with the Alouettes in the lead, Double D was out there to carry the ball, to protect the ball, to run the clock, and help us win the game. AC handled the ball to Double D, and he not only did the job of taking care of the football, but he basically signed the check to let our opponents know who we were. Not just a flashy, precision football team with a great running back and Avon Coburn and the CFL's greatest player in Anthony Calvillo, but a physically dominant team that could relentlessly pound and punish a defense into submission and keep our offense on the field, our defense off the field during the most dynamic part of a CFL game, the last 3 minutes. Double D was our guy. He was our closer. So finally, today as we say goodbye, I just want to remember, all of us to remember, and it's already been said here today, what an incredible person this man was. I hope we honor his memory by embodying the qualities he so beautifully displayed and taught all of us who were part of his life. His gift for Gab, which brought Pete together, was unmatched. His work ethic above all. But he also was authentic, had humility, was trustworthy and selfless. So Double D, we all love you here. You may no longer be with us, but your spirit will remain in our hearts and thoughts as you always bring a smile to our face. We're eternally grateful for the time we've had with you and most importantly, the life lessons you taught us both on and off the field. And I'll just close here. Rika called me the other day and asked me if I had, back in Montreal, we had this little, I threw a card in the player's locker so they could put in their wallets. And Rika asked me if I had it, and I didn't have a copy of it in hand, but I had the card on a picture. And I wanted to share it with you because Double D had this in his wallet, and how many wallets did he lose along the way, right? And so I hope, you know, by sending that to Rika, he'll have it forever. But this was something that I gave the players, and I think more than anything, when I read it to myself this morning, it reminded me of Double D, so I'll just share it with you and I'll close. I am a disciplined and unselfish player. On a disciplined and unselfish football team, I will be totally prepared to play passionately and violent with an edge within the framework of the rules out of respect for my teammates, our opponent, and the game. And I am grateful, the game I am grateful to be playing. I accept the responsibility to man up and be accountable to my teammates and coaches on and off the field. Because what we do for ourselves dies with us, but what we do for others lives on forever. Once again, my heart goes out to Karen and Rika and the family on this day of remembrance. May Double D rest in peace, and may his memories be a blessing.
Thank you, Coach. Beautiful words and beautiful memory. Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask the congregation to join us in singing this old, beautiful hymn, Amazing Grace.
Oh, sorry. It's okay, Pastor. I just want to speed it up.
Just hold on a bit there, Pastor. Hold on. We got one more. My name is Roberto Bubba Allen. As most of you guys know me in the football world, I'm currently the president of Scarborough Thunder. Dahrran, you know, a brother of mine, we played together as kids. And in my last year of high school, he convinced me to come to Cedarbrough. You know, I grew up in Glendower, he grew up in Alton Towers. You know, we shared a lot of memories, a lot of days at my house. We spent a few New Years together. You know, every morning we'd connect on the finish line to go to Cedarbrough. So before I start, you know, last night I tried to write something. I just couldn't, you know what I mean? My phone, I just kept putting down and said, I'm just gonna speak from my heart. So. Before I start, I want to call up all my Scarborough Thunder, Cedarbrough brothers and coaches that's, you know, played or coached Dahrran. I want you guys to join me up here because, you know, this is Dahrran. This is the way Dahrran would want it. So can you guys come up? All right, Pastor, I'm gonna respect the time, and I'm just gonna, you know, say a few things. And I'm speaking, like I said, not just for me, you know, everybody you see here, you know, either from Cedarbury, Thunder, you know, a lot of guys here, coaches, you know, they're the reason why Dahrran got the start and why, you know, he just flourished. So, you know, a lot of these guys here made a difference in Dahrran's life somehow or you know, another, and definitely he made an impact in our life. So, you know, growing up in Thunder, you know, seeing a player like Dahrran and what Dahrran did was just remarkable. Here's, you know, I shared the same journey with him, a kid from Jamaica, brought up with a single mother. You know, that's how me and him connected more than anything. You know, Miss Diedrick, you know, her and my mom, you know, they were good friends. Talk a lot. They share the same bond. You know, having, you know, kids come up from a country to come here for a better life. So, you know, I really, that was one of the things that me and Dahrran connected a lot. You know, he was definitely a proud Jamaican. Just seeing him from a young age. You know, as you can see the pictures outside, this guy's posing Heisman pose. He always said it. I'm gonna go to the league. I'm gonna make it. And you know, at that time, it wasn't normal for a Canadian kid coming out of this country to go big time. And, you know, he nothing was handed to this guy. He worked his butt off, whether he needed to do what he had to do academically, on the field, you know, in the gym. He made sure nothing stopped him. And, you know, just being a teammate of him, and I think, you know, as we got older and became coaches, and I look back and see, wow, you have a player on your team, someone you're close with, getting recruited by Nebraska, Michigan. Like, I don't understand. I don't think some people know how surreal that is. And it was almost like when Dahrran made it, we made it. You know what I mean? He a lot of people looking from the outside would think, oh, he's arrogant, he's about himself. But I'll tell you this, on the field, Dahrran, he was a team player. He would do anything he's got to do to make sure his team win. And that doesn't, you know, just because he's a great player, that doesn't mean it's handed. Because a lot of great players, they just do what they got to do for them. But Dahrran wanted to win. And, you know, he held us to that level. And I got frustrated with him a lot, you know, especially at Cedarbury. You know, I was his fullback. He was in my ears every game. Oh, I need you to make that block. I need you to do this. I'm like, Dahrran, leave me alone. I got it. Every game, every play, he comes back in the huddle. He's looking at me. You know, you could have blocked him that way. I'm like, Dahrran, you just got 20 yards. Like, what are you complaining about? And it was just constant with him. But you know what? He held us to that level. And, you know, that's why, you know, us Scarborough kids, you know, we were special. And, you know, he was one of the guys that held us to that level. And that's why we played. And this is why you see that, you know, the organization. We've had so many kids come out, you know, made it to the next level. And he was one of the first to do it. He set that bar. He set that standard. And, you know, he'll forever, ever be a Thunder legend. And, you know, I can't, you know, say how much, you know, I'm going to miss him. And, you know, just, you know, as we became adults, you know, he made the pros. You know, I started coaching as a young age. He was never too big. I brought him back. He would spend his entire summer helping me coach, whether it was coaching the 10-year-old team that I coach or the 16-year-olds. Dahrran was there all week coaching. You know, then he'd go to training camp. He was never, never too big to come back and give back. And, you know, that is the one thing, you know, I mean, like, I appreciate with him. And, you know, even as we got older, you know, I became a scout for the Rough Riders. And, you know, him, Dahrran, and Jermaine Gabriel, one of our Thunder kids, were on the Argos sideline. It was, you know, at one point, I'm on Saskatchewan sideline, and I look over and I see the two of them. You know, it was just a special moment to, you know, to say, wow, here are these three little Scarborough kids, you know, doing something special. So, like I said, I don't want to take up too much time, but, you know, this guy right here, man, he's just a great person. Like I said, it's bigger than football with him. You know, we spent a lot of time together off the field, you know, a lot of time going to school together. You know, he just had this work ethic, this drive, and... You know, Sullivan said it, Coach Tressman said it. I really don't think I've seen Dahrran upset. Like, Dahrran, you know, even you're pissed off, you would you know, do something silly to make you laugh or, you know, one of those things. This guy was just always a happy guy, but I'll tell you this, when he got on the field, he switched it. You know, he was just beast mode. It was like, and like I said, you know, looking back, it was just, you know, it was an honor playing alongside, you know, one of the biggest stars to ever come out of this country. You know what I mean? Going to high school with him, hanging with him, and, you know, Dahrran's going to be missed. And, you know, I speak about from all my teammates here and all my coaches, and I know they feel the same way. So we just want to say, you know, condolences to the family. You know, Kendrick, you know, you and I, we've had some talks, you know, and your dad's proud of you, man. I know, you know, when the night it happened, you put up that, you know, I'm going to make you proud. You've already made him proud. Trust me on that. All right, so I just want to say, rest in peace, Dahrran. You're going to be missed. Thunder for life, brother. We got one chair that Dahrran was part of the one who actually started us when we went to a tournament in Daytona. We were like, what, 16? And we that's where we got the Scarborough Zoo from. So Mr. Farmer here, who was one of the main guys, him and Dahrran, came back with the zoo. And if you see the zoo on my son's jersey, that's what we represent. Stand up, Romeo. Look at the back. Okay, this is that's our nickname now, the zoo. This is where we got that from that year we went to Florida. So
Scarborough!
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Hallin. Let me apologize again to you, and I just want to let you and your teammate know that we are friends. I need your friendship. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together again for them. I'm going to ask the congregation to join us in singing this beautiful song, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
Sound that saved a wretch.
Come on, let's give God praise for the life of Double D. Come on, put your hands together. God gave him to us, even though for a short moment, but we must praise God for his life. Amen. It is time for the third reading of the scripture. Gene Moulton will be coming to us now.
Morning, church. Next reading is taken from Revelation 21, verses 1 to 7. Then I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth, and the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautiful dress for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with man, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And he shall wipe away all tears from our eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Who he who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of the waters of life. He who overcomes shall inherit all this, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. This is the word of the Lord.
At this time, Veronique Bunton, on behalf of Dahrran's mother, Miss Karen Moulton, and Dahrran's partner, Rika, will be coming with a special tribute.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Veronique Bunton. I am mother to Kendrick and Dominique, Dahrran's oldest children. I've been blessed and honored to share tributes written by both Rika and Karen. For obvious reasons, it was too difficult for them to come up this morning, so I'm happy to share their last words to Dahrran. I will start with Rika's tribute. My dearest Dahrran, as I stand here today surrounded by loved ones who have come to pay their respects, my heart is heavy with grief and yet overflowing with love for you. Today we gather to celebrate the life of a remarkable man, someone who touched our lives in countless ways. Dahrran was a loving partner, a devoted father, and an amazing son. Dahrran was an exceptional soul, a beacon of strength, love, and unwavering support. He was a pillar of stability, someone you could always rely upon in times of joy and in times of sorrow. His love knew no bounds, and he gave himself selflessly to those around him. As a partner, Dahrran embodied the true meaning of partnership and commitment. We were a team. He stood by your side through thick and thin, sharing in the joys and triumphs and providing unwavering support during challenges and setbacks. As a father, Dahrran leaves behind a beautiful legacy. He showered his children with love, guidance, and an unwavering belief in their potential. He taught them the importance of integrity, compassion, and the value of hard work. Dahrran was their guiding light, their rock, and his absence will be deeply felt. Dahrran touched the lives of all who had the privilege of knowing him. His warm smile, his infectious laughter, and his genuine interest in others' well-being made him a treasured friend. He had an uncanny ability to lift spirits and make even the toughest times a little brighter. His friendship was a precious gift, one that will be cherished by all who were fortunate enough to experience it. Beyond his personal relationships, Dahrran lived a life of purpose and impact. He pursued his passions with fervor, leaving an indelible mark on his profession, his community, the world around him. His unwavering dedication, his leadership, and his unwavering commitment to making a difference inspired us all. Today, let us hold on to the lessons he taught us, the importance of love, kindness, and the pursuit of one's dreams. Dahrran, my love, you were my rock, my partner, my best friend. From the moment we met in Montreal, I knew that I had found my soulmate. Your love filled my life with joy, laughter, and a sense of completeness that I never thought possible. I want to thank you for the love you poured into every aspect of our lives. Thank you for the tender moments we shared, the adventures we embraced and embarked upon, and the simple joys discovered together. Thank you for the laughter that echoed throughout our home and the tears we wiped away as a testament to our strength. Although you may no longer be physically by my side, I carry you with me always in my heart and in my thoughts. Your kindness, your compassion, your unwavering love will continue to guide me as I navigate this new chapter without you. I find comfort in knowing that you are now at peace, free from pain and suffering. Rest, my love, and know that your memory will forever be cherished. I will keep the flame of our love burning brightly, honoring your life by living each day to the fullest. Though this goodbye feels amazingly final, I hold on to the belief that one day we will be reunited. Until then, I carry you in my heart, and your spirit will forever be a part of me. Goodbye for now, my beloved Dahrran. I will love you always and forever. Rest peacefully, babe. With all my love, Rika. I want to end on the note of a tribute from a loving mother to her loving son. I speak on behalf of Karen Moulton, mother to Dahrran Diedrick, whom she was so extremely proud of, and he so cherished her. From Karen: Dahrran, you are the shining star in my life. Now that shining star has dimmed. I will always keep you in my heart. I will always love you. I will always miss your compliments, your kisses goodnight, and your radiant smile that would light up a room. I will miss hearing you always say, "I love you, Mommy," at the end of every conversation. Your light will continue to shine in my heart, and memories of you will also forever live on in my heart. I love you, my dearest Dahrran. Thank you for coming into my life. Thank you for the joy that you brought to my life. Rest. Be with the angels where you so fittingly belong, as you, my son, are a very special angel. Take care, I love you. Until we see each other again, my dearest Dahrran, with love, from Mommy, Karen Moulton.
This time, we'll be having a video presentation.
Expecting the worst, are you gonna drop the bomb or not?
let us die young or let us live forever. We don't have the power, but we never say never. Sitting in a sandpit, life is a short trip. The music's for the sad man. Forever young, I wanna be forever young. Do you really want to live forever? Forever and ever.
Dahrran, my friend, my brother, I will forever cherish the times we spent together. I will forever be thankful for the time, you know, you came to North Dakota when Casey was in the hospital and supported us there for that week. I'll never forget the time we, you know, spent supporting you, you know, along your football journey, Penn State, Nebraska, Rose Bowl, some great times, you know, in Green Bay when, you know, you made it to the league, and, you know, Montreal with the Alouettes. I'll never forget the times, the many Super Bowl parties we had together, laughing, arguing, and, you know, enjoying each other. I'll never forget how you supported my kids in terms of their training and preparation, and you were there as a motivator and support for them. Dahrran, there are so many things that I can talk about, but you are one of the best of friends that someone can have. And I wish you peace in the ever after, and look forward to the day when we meet again. Take care, my friend.
His personality, the fact that he was so kind, he, being around people, he'll make everyone feel comfortable, no matter who that person is. And he was always very loving, a genuine person, very good heart, and he was very special. Yeah, he was a special person.
Happy birthday, dear Dahrran. Happy birthday to you.
It's a video, Dahrran, for me.
Oh, you're videoing.
Okay. Thank you. The girl in my life for all time. Mama, mama, you know I love you. Ooh, you know I love you. Mama, mama, you're the queen of my heart. Your love is like tears from the stars. Yes, it's it. Mama, loving you is like food to my soul.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Two guys from the Montreal Alouettes in the Grey Cup. They have brought Kerry Carter, yes, fullback, Montreal Alouettes. Dahrran Diedrick, fullback, Montreal Alouettes. You guys both went to high school in Toronto.
Yes. Yes.
You were 1 year ahead, right? Mm-hmm. Were you guys rivals with that? Did you know of each other? You're both kind of legends.
Oh, we definitely knew about each other, just from, like, it's not a small city, but it's a small city when it comes down to guys that are getting scholarships to go away.
Okay, I got to ask you this question. Spell his name.
D-A-H-R-R-A-N.
Wow.
Yeah.
Dahrran, where's Kerry from?
Trinidad, Tobago.
Where? Port of Spain. You missed
Port
it.
Of Spain, yeah,
where's he from?
St. Anne's, Jamaica.
Whoa.
The only thing you do for success, there's no discount. It's sweat, it's blood, it's tears. There is no discount. You can't get 50% off. It's sweat, it's blood, it's tears. There are no shortcuts to success. Stop thinking they are, and stop wanting people to put you somewhere that you didn't earn.
How you doing, everybody? My name is Avon Coburn. I had the privilege and honor of rooming with the Diedrick and playing with the Diedrick. We were running backs together at the Montreal Alouettes. The guy had a heart of gold. Never had anybody speak bad about him because he was just always positive and upbeat. And a quick story is that he was a guy that was ripped up. You know, God, he called himself a Greek god. And if he didn't, everybody else did. But he said, hey, if you wanted to get your body like mine, you got to eat raw broccoli. So I started eating raw broccoli. And I love you, brother, to the family. I love you as well. And God bless you guys.
Greetings, family, friends, fans, and former teammates. My name is Khalil Carter, and I'm a former Montreal Alouette player and coach. I just want to give my special condolences to the family, Karen, kids, siblings. Dahrran was the most genuine and authentic friend and teammate that I've had, and heaven gained an angel today. God bless you, Double D. I'll see you at the crossroads, brother. And then spin me around till I fell asleep. Then up the stairs he would carry me. And I knew for my name is Willie Miller. I was a former starting fullback for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Had the opportunity to play with Dahrran Diedrick. Wanted to just share a story about him. One of my fond ones. 1999 against Kansas State. Made a lot of fumbles. Buckhalter had one. Alexander had one. So Diedrick was in. Came in there all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. And I reminded him, man, you stepped on this campus looking like a grown man. Now's the time for you to run like one. Follow me through the hole. And man, he went off. I'm gonna miss you, man.
This is Kerry Carter, and Dahrran and I started off as rivals growing up in the Toronto area playing football, went on the parallel paths in college and at Nebraska and at Stanford, and you know, even then had our journey through the NFL, and then got together as teammates in the CFL and became more than teammates, friends and brothers, and I'll truly miss him.
I look at you, looking at me. Now I know why they say the best things are free. I'm gonna love you, boy, you are so fine. Angel of mine. It's been a long day without you, my friend.
My name is Randy Drew. I played with the Montreal Alouettes in 2007. That's where I met Dahrran at. Awesome man, awesome teammate, great father. I just want to share my condolences with the family and his kids. You will be missed, brother, but to know that you are no longer in pain and in a better place is what consoles me and what keeps me content. So to the family, love you all. Love Dahrran. Miss you very much, sir. Everybody take care.
I know we love to hit the road and laugh, but something told me that it wouldn't last. Had to switch up, look at things different, see the bigger picture.
From the champion Montreal Alouettes, Kerry Carter and Dahrran.
After the game, I had to turn around and I looked specifically at some guys and looked them right in the eyes and just pointed to let them know, you guys are all here, but we're the ones going home with the cup.
That's gotta be awesome.
And I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. When I see you again.
I am so glad that I didn't have any aspirations to play football. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together again for that presentation. Jennifer Lewin will be coming to minister in song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. After her, the eulogy will come from Anne-Marie Moulton and Sandra Moulton.
Great is thy God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Oh, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have need in thine hands, have always provided. Great. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth thine
afternoon, everyone. My name is Sandra Moulton, aunt of the deceased. And standing with me is my cousin, Anne Marie Moulton. We are both honored to eulogize Dahrran Diedrick. This was a group effort. His families and friends all contributed to what we will be sharing today. We would like to formally acknowledge those who are gathered here in person and by live stream. We especially would like to acknowledge his coaches, teammates, and fans. We sincerely appreciate your presence, prayers, and kind gestures during this difficult time. We will start the eulogy in a chronological order, highlighting Dahrran's early years, his professional life, and then we will end with some fond memories of him. Despite our pain and heavy hearts, it is vital that we pay fine tribute to this humble, wonderful young man. This is what Dahrran, Double D, my Dare, would want us to do. I will start with his early years and his professional life. Dahrran Dean Diedrick was born in St. Anne's, Jamaica, on January 11, 1979, to Karen Angela Moulton and Kenneth Diedrick. He died on June 24, 2023, age 44, in Toronto, Canada. While growing up in Jamaica, Dahrran attended Baptist Basic School and Brownstown Primary School. In Jamaica, Dahrran had resided with his young mother, Karen. Surrounded by his loving grandmother, Louise, four aunts, two uncles, and a cousin. They showered him with love and affection, but they ensured Dahrran knew respect. Although his mother was young, she thought it was God's will to bless her with a child who would be her only one. She was so proud of Dahrran and loved him dearly. From the day he entered the world and shared a unique bond. A bond that will never be broken. Church was an important part of Dahrran's life. Dahrran attended Retirement District Pentecostal Church in St. Anne, a short distance from his home. Sunday was a special day to worship with his mother and family members, which played a crucial role in his upbringing. As he grew older and developed the love for church, he was always eager to participate in Sunday school. This is where he learned to read Bible verses and pray. When an opportunity came for his mother to migrate to Canada in 1981, she was fearful and sad to leave Dahrran so young. But she knew his family would care for him as she would. Although his mother was away, she insists his grandmother and aunts taught him the meaning of respect from a young age. Karen strongly believed that love must be combined with excellent values, and she instilled cultural and core values in Dahrran early. Dahrran may have been too young to understand what the values are, but he listened and followed through. He migrated to Toronto, Canada on March 5, 1988, at the tender age of 9 years old. During his early years in Canada, he resided at Bathurst in the west end of the city. There he attended Forest Hill Elementary School. Later on, Dahrran and his mother, Karen, moved to the east end of the city, where he settled at Halton Towers, a mixed neighborhood in Scarborough, where he attended Albert Campbell High School before transferring to Cedar Brae College Gate Institute. Dahrran's love for athletics began at the tender age of 9. At 9 years old, he and his friend had a race. And guess who won? Dahrran, of course. His friend told Dahrran that he was a football player. Dahrran, being a competitive person, told his friend that if he learned to play the game of football, he bet he would become better than his friend. He eventually did, and proved that everything is so able and is doable and that nothing was impossible. I will talk about his professional hair. In high school, he was a leader. While in the 10th grade, he knew what he wanted to do and the school he wanted to attend. What separates Dahrran from his friends were the fact that they had talents and skill and talk about it. Dahrran, on the other hand, put in the work all day and every day. He did not wait for things to happen. He made them happen. He played high school ball at Cedar Bray College Gate Institute and rushed for almost 1,900 yards in 9 games as a senior. Post-university and during his NFL and CFL and college years, Derek was drafted in the Edmonton Eskimo in the 3rd round, 24th overall, in 2002 CFL draft, but returned to school for his senior year. Dahrran attended the University of Nebraska Lincoln degree, the University of Nebraska Lincoln, in the top football college in the nation where they bred the best running back. He wanted to be where the best of the best were, and he made it happen. He became the Cornhuskers' first Canadian recruit to receive a scholarship in 1998. He played college football for Nebraska from 1999 to 2002. In 2001, he became a starter in an offense featuring the Heisman Trophy winning quarterback Eric Couch. He led the Big 12 Conference with 1,299 rushing yards and scored 15 touchdowns. He always set high goals and achieved them. Dahrran finished his 4-year career at Nebraska with 502 carries for 2,745 yards and 26 touchdowns, and earned his undergraduate criminal justice degree with a 3.165 cumulative grade point average in 2001. He was in pursuit of a master's degree in the same subject, but was unable to complete it. Here are some highlights of Dahrran's NFL career history as a football player. In 2003, he played for the San Diego Chargers. In 2003 to 2004, he played for the Green Bay Packers. In 2004, he played for the Washington Redskins. In 2005 to 2006, he played for Edmonton Eskimo and won his first Grey Cup championship following the Eskimos' victory over the Montreal Alouettes in the 93rd Grey Cup game. 2006 to 2013, he played for Montreal Alouettes as a running back. In 2013, he played for the Hamilton Tiger Cats. In 2014, he resigned with Montreal Alouettes and played 4 games that year. That was the last season for his football career because of his lymphoma diagnosis. He recorded his highest single season rushing total in 2008. Where he had 42 carries for 263 yards. He won his second career Grey Cup championship in 2009, a victory over the Saskatchewan Rough Riders. He scored his first career touchdown against the Toronto Argonauts on October 29, 2010. He capped off the 2010 season by winning his third Grey Cup following his 98th Grey Cup game. In 2011, he scored his first 6 rushing touchdowns of his career, while also recording 49 carries for 196 yards. Here are some of his highlights of his career and awards. In 2005, 2009, and 2010, he was a three-time Grey Cup champion. In 2001, he was awarded the second team All Big 12. He earned a total of 5 rings, 2 from Montreal, 1 from Edmonton, and 1 from his coaching. He received 1 from the Argos and 1 from the Dolphins. Overall, he played in 130 career CFL games, where he had 179 carries for 872 yards and landed 6 touchdowns along with 49 special teams tackles. Dahrran was a big picture guy who had clear goals and a vision for his life. His mental discipline and fortitude before and after the games were admirable. He had bull's-eye focus and an unstoppable drive. It was said that people were good at what they do, but Dahrran made them better. His friends remember him during those years as hardworking, dedicated, and always putting in the work. Whenever his friends would make plans to go out, Dahrran would say, "No, I'm going to practice." During his off season, he would go back to Montreal and Toronto to inspire kids at schools. How incredible. A true champion, undefeated, unmatched, unchallenged, and will certainly be unforgotten. He always made the best decisions to achieve his career goals. His friend Casey, who is no longer with us, received a scholarship for football while he was alive, all because of Dahrran. His son Kendrick aspired to follow in his dad's footsteps and is now embarking on a collegiate football career. His habits became his friends' habits. His ambition became their ambition. His character traits were admired by all whom he came in contact with. As an Heisman candidate in the third year of Nebraska, Dahrran won the Russian title in the Big 12 as a running back. An highlight of his career and a massive year for Dahrran. His first big game in Pennsylvania will forever remain an incredible memory for his friends and family. Playing Penn State in front of 100,000 people was an highlight of his football career. It was a really exciting time for him, and he wanted his friends and his mother to see him play. As recalled by his friends, that moment will forever be etched in their minds. Flying down to see Dahrran to Pasadena for his national championship was another memory of that his friend Josh will never forget. Looking back, he remembered just the games. Dahrran asked to go with him on a walk, but he was shocked, thinking, why would you do that before your game? But Dahrran wanted to take a moment to connect with his friends before the game. It was his way of showing how much he valued their friendship, and they always walked together, never apart. He was that kind of guy. Dahrran was a professional trainer who trained and motivated athletes. He managed his time wisely and made the most of each day. During the COVID-19 pandemic, he trained his young children, also his friends, most of whom received athletic scholarships simply because of Dahrran. His friend Brian remembered him as someone who was always focused. While they were out partying and drinking, Dahrran would be focusing on football. He knew where he was going and what he wanted. He had the drive and the passion to succeed at any cost. All speak of his character. At a very young age, he mapped out his whole life and did everything possible to accomplish his dreams. Following his recovery, he spent the 2017 season as a strength and conditioning coach for the Toronto Argonauts, winning his 4th Grey Cup. While in remission, Dahrran never lost hope. He went right back to what he loved. And and became a personal trainer at Lifetime Fitness, where he ended up as one of the top five highest ranked fitness trainer. During his professional years, he was known to be a high achiever. He loved people and would later on transition into training and mentoring young kids, where he got involved with a sewing program. The purpose of the program was to discipline, motivate, and encourage them to be great. This became one of his favorite jobs outside of playing football, and he loved it. Even though he did not always have the physical strength to train effectively, he showed us at every games and at school with his five friends and taught the kids how to sew. He was truly one of a kind. Thank you very much. And Marie would be focusing on his fondest memories. Thank you.
That was great. That was really, really good. I'm so proud of you, Sandra, for doing that. Hello, everyone. My name is Anne Marie, and I'm the cousin of Dahrran. I'm going to talk to you about some fond memories of Dahrran, and some of it might make you laugh, but this is why we're here, not just to celebrate the sad passing, but also to rejoice about the happy memories. Dahrran was known not only for his amazing touchdowns, but he was also known for his ability to connect with others personally and professionally. And people were fond of him wherever he went and always wanted his autograph. And he would warmly oblige, leaving everyone feeling welcome and appreciated. So let me begin this journey of fond memories with his favorite person. I bet you know his favorite person is his mom. Dahrran adored his mom, Karen. She meant the world to him as he did to her. She remembered him wanted to play football from he was young and how he went playing in the neighborhood with a little boy who claimed he was a football player. Dahrran decided to learn the game and believed that one day he would become better than his friend. And in his own words, if I could beat him, I could be better than him. Dahrran left that game motivated to win, and he went on a personal assignment seeking help so he could become better at playing the game. She remembered his first job at 10 years old, where he had his own newspaper route and brought her a pair of sneakers with his first paycheck, while thanking her, as always, for being a great mom. Dahrran never failed in reminding his mom of his love for her and that she was his whole world wrapped up in one person. Karen described her son as affectionate, loving, and someone who gave compliments freely. He would hug her every night before he goes to bed, and every conversation always ends with, "Mom, I love you." In her words, he was the best son wrapped up in 100 sons. Dahrran's dad, Kenneth, who's here with us today, remembered taking his son to the farm with him as a child in Jamaica, and that Dahrran always showed him a special kind of love, the kind that melts his heart. A year ago, Dahrran brought his dad a cow he called Brown Girl because she's so pretty. To this day, Ken would look at the cow and remember his son's kindness and his love. He described Dahrran as a loving son. In Kenneth's words, "I don't have much to say, except Dahrran is the best, and all I can say is, I lost a loving son." He loved his kids wholeheartedly, as we've heard so many things said about them today. His oldest son, Dominique, shared a story of how her and her dad went walking one day, something they always do together. Spending quality time was Dahrran's love language, just in case you wonder. On this particular day, they were both walking when her dad stopped to pick a flower and put it in her hair, smiled at her and told her she was as beautiful as the flower in her hair. They wrote a song together called Rolling and performed it for each other as he played the guitar. That was the kind of father he was, present and always affirming her worth. Dahrran underwent a stem cell transplantation in June 2016, and guess who served as his donor? Dominique. His health returned, and on June 30th of every year, Dahrran would celebrate a second birthday because of his daughter, Dominique. She gave him a second chance at life. No wonder he held a special place in his heart for her. Dominique remembered her dad teaching her how to ride a bike. The day she fell off her bike, he quickly picked her up in her arms and told her, "Show me your muscles and make a flex." He would remind her of the muscles every time she had a fall and told her to be proud of her muscles. They had a real bond, and Dominique would go to the hospital at times to feed her dad. He loved to drink Ensure. And she would feed him that drink, and he would tell her how much he loved her because she was as sweet as the Ensure. She remembered one particular day upon visiting with her dad in the hospital, he wanted to try out Mary Brown's chicken, and she went searching for it and found that they were under construction. And unfortunately, Dahrran just had to settle for Jollibees. Reminding her, though, of how much he was grateful for her kindness and her love. So let's talk about Kendrick, AKA Kenny. Remembered many conversations about his dad, Dahrran, and Dahrran would remind his son, Kenny, "You can do anything you put your mind to." Chastening him at times to love, to remember not to put too much peanut butter on his sandwich, something he just couldn't understand, for it was kind of weird to him. They did everything together. Basketball was Kenny's first and favorite sport. He and his dad would play, and Dahrran, being taller, would always beat Kenny on the one-on-one. And Kenny remembered their last game playing basketball. It ended with a tie, so that's good. His dad was his coach, attended all of his games, and even coached Kenny's team. Kenny later on developed the love of basketball, the love of football, because of his dad. His friends now enjoyed football because of his dad and described Dahrran as their favorite coach. Kenny's sentiment for his dad is that he taught him everything. He made sure Kenny got his driver's license before he went off to university. They shared love for video games, computers, and his love for the camera. Kenny summed it up like this: "I look at myself, and everything about me comes from my dad." Kenny's now attending UBC, and his dad was very proud to know that his son got into the University of British Columbia, where he's now pursuing a career in computer science, and he's also on the football team. Isla remembered every time her dad would visit her, he would be so happy to see her. He cared for all of them and wanted to be the best they could be. He would send her birthday text every February the 18th. For Isla, the hardest thing is losing her dad and not seeing him before he passed. One of Isla's fondest memories of her dad was when she showed up to her elementary school and had lunch with her and her friends. Dahrran was very attentive and noticed Isla's love for American Girl dolls, so he purchased one that looked like her, and he would help Isla to dress the doll. Isla believed her dad loved everybody and that everybody loved him. Dahrran was proud that Isla was an athlete. Of all his children, she remembered them doing CrossFit together, and he pushed himself so hard he puked. Isla competed for nationals in weightlifting for the Olympics in 2017 at 12 years old. She's currently playing track and is a thrower for her track team. Isla described her dad as caring and very determined. He wanted others to strive for their best, and she loved that about him. Rika, we've heard so much about his partner, Rika, for 12 years. She remembered Dahrran as someone dear to her heart, traveling buddies who traveled for every chance they got because he always loved to travel for work too. And during their travels, people would naturally just connect with him, and she would be so mesmerized, like, "What is it about you?" People just loved Dahrran everywhere he went. And she reminded us, as we've heard so many times today, of how much he cared for his kids, and that when he first got ill in Montreal, his first words were, "What's going to happen to my kids?" And she stood by his side and reminded him that everything will be fine. She knew that he loved her as much as she loved him. And Rika's fondest memories of him is summed up in a few heartfelt words. "I love him. His smile was my everything. He was loving, caring, and affectionate, a partner and a best friend who was genuine with his love and intentional with his time. Rika loved when Dahrran called her name, always wanting to know if she was sleeping already, wanting her to know how much she was loved, a kind soul, always calm, peaceful, and easygoing. His last wish was to get himself a smoker when he was discharged from the hospital. The whole time he was hospitalized, he would watch videos on how to cook on the smoker. And yes, he was going to come home and cook brisket and turkey and all the meat he could get on his smoker." Rika recalled one time through her 12 years that Dahrran got upset, and that is when the lady ran into his truck at the gas station. And that showed how much he loved himself. It's something we all know, and that he loved the mirror. He had a healthy self-esteem and was proud of himself and carried himself very well. She would like us to know that Dahrran loved his kids very much and made sure that they knew that they were loved. He was a great father, a well-loved son, a special nephew, a kind little brother, an amazing cousin, and a trusted friend, and a hard-working teammate, as we've heard today. He was an inspiration to all. Dahrran will always remain in our hearts because that is where he belongs. Kendrick and Dominique's mom, Vernique, you've heard Vernique today, fondly remembers the two of them as teenagers. They met at a summer camp, and she recalls him walking around with a tattered piece of paper at all times. On it, he had his vision for his life written down. He was no more than 15 years old. What was so amazing that is that she watched Dahrran accomplish all of his goals he had written down on that tattered piece of paper. He would always talk about going pro and going into the NFL, and he did that. Dahrran only had one thing on the list that he didn't get to accomplish, which is the Heisman Trophy, though he was a candidate for it. She also remembered him and his Saturday morning's workouts when they were teens. He would clean his mom's place on Saturday while dancing to the sound of music loud in the background. Mind you, he would not touch that vacuum until he was fully geared up. You wanna know what his favorite outfit was? Cleaning in his little shorts, a tight undershirt, and sweatbands on both of his wrists and his head while he worked away cleaning the house, dancing like no one's watching to the eye of the tiger. At the end of the day's performance, you could bet the whole house was spotless. He truly had a great sense of humor, was keen on working out, and was always doing whatever needed to be done to make his mom proud. He was fascinated with movies and shows. Regardless of how bad it ends, he would watch it till the end. And he would do this even while he was hospitalized. He had all the series down pat: Netflix, Disney Channel, Prime, Apple TV. He loved a good documentary. He loved Fox News and he loved CNN. He was unbiased. He believed in hearing both sides of the story and remind you of the importance of always listen to both sides and do not be biased. His Aunt Sandra, who read earlier, was affectionately known to him as Auntie Dean. She called him her favorite nephew and remembered him as a smooth guy. That's the reason she called him Bishop as a child, because he was always well-groomed. Some of her fondest memories of him was remembering him as always fixing his hair and patting it back into place. He also loved ripe bananas and would eat a lot of it at one time. She's most proud that he carried her name as Dean as a middle name, such an honor. His aunt Marveth, who helped to raise him during his childhood years, described him as very special to her. He was not only her loving nephew, but he was like a son. And Aunt Clover, Bibbs, as he would call her, was never short of compliments when he was alive and in the hospital. He would always let her know how much he loved her. When he was a child, he loved hot chocolate and wanted to drink it out of a big mug. He loved food, and every time she would give him a mug of hot chocolate, he would throw the mug away. And guess why? That was his way of telling Auntie Clover that he needed more, and in the same amount. Aunt Patricia, Lorna, Dahrran was special to her, and she loved him and missed him so much. Uncle Georgie and Quentin both have fond memories of him as well that spans beyond his childhood years. For Uncle Georgie, he remembered his nephew helped him to navigate the city the first time he came to Canada. Dahrran had a real good sense of direction. On Friday evenings, Dahrran would meet up with his Uncle Georgie to get his hair cut, a weekly practice until he left for college. And Quentin remembered Dahrran as his little brother and how growing up together, he was kind and he was affectionate. He was a happy person at all times. He cares a lot for others and was respectful and kind to everyone. He would tell you how much he loved you every day. In Quentin's own words, he will be deeply missed, and I will miss hanging out with him and will truly miss his smiles. Dahrran was a born leader, a positive role model, and a faithful friend. Josh remembered him while he was in North Dakota and facing his darkest hour, how it was Dahrran that was there for him. His friend Jerome held an hilarious memory of him on a night when they went to the club. Upon leaving the club, Dahrran claimed he was hungry and he wanted burritos. 3 o'clock in the morning, by the way. Jerome thought that was a bad idea to eat burritos at that time in the morning, but you know Dahrran, he was hungry. Even after telling him that it wasn't a good idea to eat burritos that late, not being able to take no for an answer, he went ahead and he had his burrito. Well, that didn't end up too good. While Rome was driving on the highway, here Dahrran come, can you pull over? Well, the final stop to that problem was the Shell gas station. And you can imagine what happened at Shell gas station. I bet you can't imagine. He went full out outside a gas station. The moral of the story is, please do not eat burritos at 3 o'clock in the morning. You might just regret it. Just a few more happy memories of Dahrran before we go, as he's remembered by his family, including his cousins, his friends, and acquaintances. From a child, he loved to dress up, picky about his hair, liked to pose and loved the mirror. He knew he was handsome, no doubt about that, and he made sure he carried himself well at all times. He loved food, and Christmas and Thanksgiving was his favorite time of the year. Guess why? Because he got to carve the turkey, by the way, and that was his way of making sure he got the turkey leg. His cousin Richie remembered him for the time they went attending a family's wedding, and Dahrran ate off all the bread off the table, ate all his food, and then ate again. Richie, remembering that moment, is still amazed at how healthy and big his appetite was for food. Another funny memory was at his last family backyard picnic when the cops showed up and Dahrran took it upon himself to go and speak with them. Of course, being a person of good manners and having a great sense of humor, he told the cops, "Sorry you came too late. The party's just finished. You should have come earlier." And like the time he and his friend Jerome went to the Brazilian steakhouse and Dahrran couldn't stop eating. The servers kept serving him food because he forgot to flip his meal card over from green to red. And afterwards, you know what happened? He kept on eating. And it was still on green, so Dahrran kept eating, and finally he turned to his friend Jerome and asked him, "Why are the servers still serving food?" And Jerome told him, "You need to flip your card over to red. If you don't, you will eat yourself to a full, I can't move situation." Dahrran loved the challenge and was highly competitive. He thought he could beat Mayweather with a little bit of training and believed that he could if he had the chance to fight him. When asked by his friends what made him believe that he could beat Mayweather, he said, "Mayweather is 125 pounds. Look at me, I'm 230 pounds. And Mayweather had baby fist and he had man fist. Sounds like him, right? He believed that Mayweather did not stand a chance with him if they were to compete, reminding his friend that he was athletic and strong, letting them know without a doubt that he was 100% positive if he could fight Floyd Mayweather, he could win him in the first round. He was truly an extraordinary guy. And Jerome and Dahrran knew each other for over 15 years. They met at the gym during Darren's NFL career. Jerome said he never saw anyone with a neck that big as Mike Tyson's. And he wanted a neck like Dahrran, so he asked Dahrran, "Why is your neck so big? And can I train with you?" And Dahrran's response to him was, "My neck is big because I play football. And yes, you can train with me." And so they trained together for 5 to 6 hours weekly, and Dahrran became his best friend and brother, and also his children's godfather. They were each other's shadow. They fished together, traveled together, and went to the club together, and watched the games together. And they developed a lasting bond for each other until Dahrran's death. He can still remember the fond memories of their final trip to Florida, where they both had fun as they dressed up in matching outfits, taking their cues from IG and Facebook. Dahrran had an eye for fashion and loved dressing up at every chance he got. Jerome also described Dahrran as closest person to his heart. They never had a fight, never argued. However, Dahrran was a great debater and never turned down an opportunity to argue a point that he was passionate about. Dahrran loved kids and enjoyed spending time with his godchildren, and they remembered how much he enjoyed them dancing with them as they all watched the show. So you think you can dance? He was a big kid at heart. Just before Dahrran passed away, they went to Vegas and hung out together. They did just about anything Dahrran wanted to do. They drove exotic cars around, attended shows, and of course, ate all the best food. They were intentional about spending quality time connecting as brothers and best friends. Sadly, it would have been their last time together. On one occasion, Jerome remembered Dahrran was not as strong and wanted to go into the pool by himself. And he actually told him not to, but Dahrran jumped in the pool. And of course, Jerome had to jump after him to help him out in the pool. Monty, his barber, for over 9 years, was with him and gave him his last haircut. Because he always wanted to look good, always in the best spirit, all through his sickness. He never gave up hope to live. And he dared to live his life unafraid. He fought a good fight and never gave up trying, always had his friends back, solidifying a brotherly love and one that forever lives on. And Brian, his friend, recalls some fond memories of him dating back 25 years. While most people saw Dahrran as a muscular footballer, Brian saw his best friend as kind, warm, and sometimes overprotective, even though Dahrran was younger. Dahrran treated him like an older brother. Like the time when Dahrran bought his ticket for him to attend one of his games, a true brother and a friend, Dahrran was loving towards him and was never afraid to tell him how much he valued their friendship. Brian will always remember Dahrran as his best friend. For many of you, he was motivating and hardworking, a bright young man, vibrant and brave, who ran the football field like a pro. He was also someone with strong arms and gave hugs that lasted hours. He carried a light within him and he had a smile that lit up every room. He was resilient and he stood brave in the face of adversity. He wasn't afraid to discipline with love. He spent quality time with his families. He worked out with his cousin, had sleepovers for them. He gave lectures, he talked to them, he'd take them to the movies, and he had a bond with everyone, with all of them. His cousin Jessica remembered that at 4 years old, she was scared to blow out her candles on her birthday, and guess who blew it out? Dahrran did. That was sweet. His cousin Rochelle remembered chatting with him in the garage after the gym, just to talk about life. He taught his little cousin Monique how to drive and has left her with a heart full of gratitude and a memory that will stay with her forever. Kiki remembered him as a big family person. He was like her brother, a go-to person you could count on to be there for you. He said what was on his mind, and he never cared about the naysayers. His uncle Ivor summed up his life as the epitome of humility, a very interesting young man who never behaved like he was better than anyone else. He was young, but mature, confident, and humble. He taught his children to have a good sense of direction and to never lose their way. He had a big spirit and was never stingy in giving hugs and I love you to his friends and families. He was caring, he was selfless, and he was just amazing. So we're coming to the end of it. Like, there's so much more I could share with you, but let me just say this one thing to you. When we combine all of these memories, and we don't have enough time to share all of them, my apology to those of you who might not have heard your memory of Dahrran. We combine all of these beautiful memories, and we can all agree that Dahrran was pretty special. He was rare and admirable. He was a young man of impeccable character, generosity, and strength, who made everyone cross this path felt incredible, loved, and appreciated. These are the moments that we will hold in our hearts of him forever. I end this eulogy with these words. If life was a book, the chapters of Dahrran's life would be a well-written book. He lived an exciting life. He was certainly not average. He was so good that no one could ignore him. He took the path less walk, and he made it into a path that we can all be proud of. He has left not only his footprints, but his handprints on our hearts, reminding us to write as many chapters as we can and to live an exciting and fulfilled life. For it's not the years in your life that counts, but the life in your years. Dahrran has truly left an indelible mark on all of our lives. May we all use these lessons from his life to pay it forward. Dahrran, Dean, Diedrick, we love you and we missed you tons. You will forever remain in our hearts. You walked the walk, you talked the talk, you came, you saw, you conquered. You did what most only dreamed of, you made it all happen. Thank you for listening, and God bless all of you.
Amen. Wonderful eulogy. We're really running behind time now. I was told at the beginning that we need to leave at 12:30. We're way behind. And Jay Smooth, may you come quickly and do your musical tribute in a minute.
But I know I'll think of you every step of the way. And
ladies and gentlemen, we are now in the final minutes of this service. And in a moment, Pastor Shireen Spencer, will be coming to pray for the family. But for the next 2-3 minutes, I just want to give us a little note of reminder. Everyone leaves. The Holy Scripture says, man that is born of a woman have few days to live, and he is full of trouble. And he said, from the dust we came, and from the dust we shall all return. The problem with this is none of us knows when we are leaving. We wish that Dahrran would have stayed longer, played longer, lived to see an old man, almost like myself, to see his grandchildren. But he didn't know when he was going. God gave him to us for a few years. We hoped he had stayed longer. But then everyone leaves. Everyone has to go. It is in the state of the unknown. So we don't know when. We don't know who's next. That should motivate us to treat each other better, to love better, to be the best self we can be, because we don't know. Sometimes we come to services like these and it's hard to define the tears, because we are not certain if they are just tears of sorrow or tears of regret. Oh, if I knew, I wouldn't have said what I said. I wouldn't have did what I did. If I knew, I would have treated him better or her better. I wouldn't have zeroed in on my brother's flaws and my sister's flaws so much. I would find something in them to celebrate. I wouldn't live in anger and unforgiveness, because everyone leaves, but we just don't know when. So the person you're sitting beside today, make sure every day you live, you let them know you love them, because you just don't know. As Dahrran's team members and friends watched him play in his strength, running, and I don't know much about football, so if I say something crazy, forgive me. Running and ducking and... I told you. And his teammate said he was a great player. I said he's a great player, too, but I wonder if he had met me, what would have happened? Well, I thank God he didn't meet me on the field, because I would still be getting up. But watching him play on the field of sport in his strength and his might, no one had it in the back of their mind that Dahrran would leave so early. But the truth of the matter is, ladies and gentlemen, everyone leaves. But we just don't know when. So I'm going to ask you to do something in my final minute standing here. Just turn to the person beside you and say, please treat me right. Yes. Tell them, because you don't know. Treat each other right, because we don't know how long God has given you to me and I to you. And in my final statement, since we don't know, ladies and gentlemen, here's what we must do. We need someone in our lives who know what we don't know. We don't know about tomorrow. We don't know what's coming next. But we need someone who can help us in the unknown. And I have the right person for you. His name is Jesus. Somebody say amen. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere at the same time. He knows what's going to happen tomorrow. Amen, amen. Somebody help me say amen. The writer said, put your hands in the hands of the man that stilled the waters. Put your hands in the hands of the man that calmed the sea. Take the name of Jesus with you. Because you don't know. Everyone leaves, but we don't know when. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, we thank the Lord for this man's life. The lessons he has taught. Let us take the torch of love that he had for everybody he met and carry it. His light must not go out. Take it up. And while you take it up, never forget to take Jesus with you. God bless you.
I had the privilege of praying with the family for 3 years, praying for Dahrran and for God to touch. And so I have the privilege of praying for the family now. I invite you all to stand, please. Dahrran was not a perfect man, but he was a saved man. And the reason that we're able to say we will see you again is because he had a commitment to the Lord. And those of us who die in Christ will rise in Christ. And so as I pray, it's because I know I can pray for the God of heaven to minister. As Pastor has said, we all go sometime. But where we go and to whom we go is all on this one thing. Do I know Jesus? And it's the comfort of Jesus and the comfort of the Father that I pray over the family right now. Heavenly Father, thank you for who you are. The God of all comfort. Thank you that you knew Dahrran and you know Dahrran. And thank you that in this time of pain and sorrow, you are ever present to comfort, to heal. Thank you, Jesus, for already sealing our victory, for knowing that when we die here on earth, that where things are not perfect, you promised to go and prepare a place for us, and you've prepared a place for Dahrran. And Jesus, because of your victory and because of your sacrifice, you have left the Holy Spirit to now be with the family, to be with the friends, to bring your comfort, to bring your healing, to bring your strength, to bring the revelation that you are present with us as we go from this place. So, Lord, in these next moments, as the family says goodbye, in these next hours, as they lay him to rest, in the next days, as they try to figure out how they will move on without him, we thank you that they do not have to do it alone. So we thank you for the power of your presence to go with us, to walk before us, to continue in the journey that you've given us breath. And we pray for each and every person here, family and friends. May they come to know you so that they can walk in your comfort and walk in the breath that you give us until you call us home. Lord, have your way in ministering, in healing, in comforting, in continuing to walk with us. We present the family, we present the friends. We present each and every person in this room to you. May we answer to you. May we accept your love. May we accept your comfort. And may we go with you as you go with us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I invite the funeral home to come and give the next instructions. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the service here for Dahrran in the sanctuary. We will be making our way to Highland Memory Gardens. That's at 33 Memory Gardens Lane. We are under police escort, and they are going to only take 30 cars. So we are asking that everyone that is traveling in procession, that you still put on your high beam lights and your four-way flashers, still obey all rules of the road unless the police flag you through, but I also just want to ensure that we get there safely. The route of the procession will be northbound on Markham Road. We'll be making a left turn onto Steeles, and then another left turn onto Don Mills, and the cemetery will be on our left-hand side, and then you can just follow the procession inside of the gardens. For those who are going ahead, please, again, drive safely. As we do depart today, we are going to ask the pastors to please lead us out. We'll ask everyone to remain in their seats until the pastors, the pallbearers will go directly behind the pastors, the casket, and then the family, subsequently starting from the front rows, will lead out to the outside. Again, for those who are going to the cemetery, I'm going to ask you to make your way directly to your vehicles. Family, also make your way directly to the limousine so that we can then make our way to the cemetery. On behalf of myself, Shelley Challenger, and the New Haven family, thank you for allowing us to serve you today. In your programs, you have a reception location. Following the entombment today, the family is inviting you back to the Audley Recreation Center at 1955 Audley Road. Please look in your programs for directions. Thank you.
Dark with your restless heart long enough, waiting for the light with your eyes shut tight and your wings wrapped up. I always knew there'd come a day I'd have to watch you fly away. So fly, fly, turn around and you're feeling down, it'll lift you up. Don't fight the winds of change, let them carry you away.
watching the skies, hoping for the best but expecting the worst. Are you gonna drop the bomb or not? Let us die young or let us live forever. We don't have the power, but we never say never. Sitting in a sandpit, life is a short trip. The music's for the sad man. Forever young, I wanna be forever young. Do you really want to live forever? Forever and ever.
Dahrran, my friend, my brother, I will forever cherish the times we spent together. I will forever be thankful for the time, you know, you came to North Dakota when Casey was in the hospital and supported us there for that week. I'll never forget the time we, you know, spent supporting you, you know, along your football journey, Penn State, Nebraska, Rose Bowl, some great times, you know, in Green Bay when, you know, you made it to the league, and, you know, Montreal with the Alouettes. I'll never forget the times, many Super Bowl parties we had together, laughing, arguing, and, you know, enjoying each other. I'll never forget how you supported my kids in terms of their training and preparation, and you were there as a motivator and support for them. Dahrran, there are so many things that I can talk about, but you are one of the best of friends that someone can have. And I wish you peace in the ever after, and look forward to the day when we meet again. Take care, my friend.
His personality, the fact that he was so kind, he, being around people, he'll make everyone feel comfortable, don't matter who that person is. And he was always very loving, a genuine person, very good heart, and he was very special. Yeah, he was a special person.
Never didn't have you. Happy birthday, dear Dahrran. Happy birthday to you.
It's a video, Dahrran, for me.
Oh, you're videoing.